This is Apollo Control at 153 hours, 7 minutes. At the present time, we are changing shifts here in Mission Control. Flight Director Gene Kranz will be coming on to relieve Flight Director Clifford Charlesworth. The capsule communicator on this shift will be astronaut Charlie Duke. There will be a change of shift briefing in the news center in the Building 1 auditorium in about 10 minutes. At the present time, Apollo 11 is traveling at a speed of 4,185 feet per second. The spacecraft is about 162,700 nautical miles from the Earth. During the change of shift briefing, we will take the circuit down, record any conversation that develops with the spacecraft, and play it back following the change of shift briefing. At 153 hours, 9 minutes, this is Apollo Control, Houston.
Thank you. Thank you. This is Apollo Control, 153 hours, 49 minutes, ground elapsed time. Apollo 11, homeward bound, is now 161,050 nautical miles out from Earth. Velocity now 4,216 feet per second. Some 3.5 minutes of recorded air-to-ground transmissions have accumulated during the recent change of shift press conference here in the Apollo News Center. Let's play that tape back now.
Houston, Apollo 11.
Go ahead, 11.
All right, just checking the radios, and how's the thruster activity coming?
11 Houston, the radios are still in good shape, and we're still waiting for your rates to decay. We've got 0.03 degrees per second in pitch now.
Okay, we're in no rush. This is a very pleasant attitude. As a matter of fact, the sun is down in the LEB, so it's not shining through the windows and heating the place up. We've got the Earth steady out window one. We have the moon steadily out window three. And, of course, we're locked up on the high gain. So as long as the thermal people are happy, we're happy.
Roger, we copy. Apollo 11, this is Houston, over.
Go ahead, Houston.
Okay, 11, we're about ready to start PTC. I'd like to give you some high gain antenna angles. Well, we'd like to operate in the react mode, and do you plan on spinning up in the positive or negative direction, over?
We can do it either way. I had planned the positive.
Okay, for positive, the high gain antenna setting should be pitch plus 30, yaw 270, and in react, over.
Understand, react, pitch plus 30, yaw 270, thank you.
Roger, and if you would, when you're making your disky entries to set up for PTC, go a little slower, and we'll try to follow each entry from down here, over.
Roger that. Houston 11, PTC established.
Roger, 11. Hmm? 11 Houston, we observe the PTC to be fairly well established here, and we'll keep you posted on how it's going, and your friendly white team commentator is taking over now.
Okay, thank all you black team.
That was the green team.
Correction, now you green team. Correction, green team, excuse me.
Roger out.
How could I forget? I used to be a green one.
Hello, Apollo 11 Houston. Your white team is now on. We're standing by for an exciting evening of TV and a free sleep report, over. Houston, you sure you don't have anybody else in there with you?
Houston, Apollo 11, say again, please.
We had some strange noises coming down on the downlink, and it sounded like you had some friends up there.
Where'd the white team go during their off hours anyway?
Say again?
Thank you.
This is Apollo Control. Still no explanation of the weird noises emanating from Apollo 11, if indeed it is from Apollo 11, and it's reported from network that it's being received on the downlink at two different stations in the manned spaceflight network. Perhaps it will all shake out later in the mission as to what these strange noises are. We'll come back up again as conversation is resumed with Apollo 11. Now 160,410 nautical miles out from Earth, traveling at 4,228 feet per second. At 154 hours, 5 minutes, ground elapsed time, this is Apollo Control.
Thank you.
This is Apollo Control. 154 hours, 53 minutes. Ground elapsed time, 40 hours, 9 minutes to entry. Apollo 11, homeward bound, 158,378 nautical miles out from Earth. Velocity now 4,267 feet per second. We have some 3 minutes of tape accumulated over the past half hour of rather minor conversations with the crew of Apollo 11. We'll roll these tapes now.
Apollo 11, Houston, over. Roger, would you verify, we've lost comm with you for about the last 10 minutes. Would you verify that the S-band track switch is in REAC, over?
Negative, it's not. Last time we broke lock, we went to auto and I left it there, sorry.
Roger, we'd like to have you to put it in REAC and monitor. In about 2 minutes, we'll be coming up on the high gain. Would you monitor the REAC if it doesn't take, acquire manually, over?
Okay, take any angles you'd like.
We'll try to switch it ourselves. Stand by on the angle. Buzz, the it's pitch plus 30, y'all 270, over.
Right there, got him.
Thank you. Hello, Apollo 11, Houston. Would you please terminate battery charge now? Over.
Roger, terminating battery charge.
Roger. Hello, Apollo 11, Houston. Any special attitude you'd like us to look at for the TV? Over.
I don't guess we have a requirement there,
John. Roger, we have an attitude that we can get the Earth out of a window, or the Moon. We're trying to look at find one that we can get both, if that's what you'd like. Over.
Our 50-degree roll attitude will probably give us that, John.
Roger.
That's a good one because it puts the Earth out window one and the Moon out window three, and it puts the Sun down the LEB, so the lighting in here remains relatively constant.
Roger, well, we'll just stop on the 50 roll in and we'll give you the word when to do that, over.
Okay.
This is Apollo Control, and that completes the accumulation of air-to-ground communications by means of tape recordings over the last half hour or so. It's quiet right now. No conversation going on between spacecraft communicator Charlie Duke and the crew of Apollo 11. And at 154 hours, 57 minutes ground elapsed time, this is Apollo Control. This is Apollo Control. 155 hours, 27 minutes ground elapsed time. Coming up now, about 3 minutes away from the tonight's television pass. It'll be through the 85-foot antenna at the Goldstone tracking station. The 210-foot dish out there is tied up tracking one of the Mars flyby missions. We have some 20 seconds of tape accumulated. We'll play that back and rejoin the conversation live.
Apollo 11 Houston, we'll have high gain coverage about 1:35:30 that time. You can turn on the TV if you desire and continue your roll around till you get 50 degrees roll. Over. Apollo 11, Houston, we're going to give you the All-Star game tonight, but it was rained out. Over. Eleven Houston, we're on a high gain. You can warm up the FM man if you'd like. Over.
This is Apollo Control, still standing by for the incoming television signal from Columbia. Still nothing but the color bar test pattern as of now. Continuing to stand by on air ground and television links.
Apollo 11, Houston, we see you coming up on 50 roll. How does that attitude look? Over. Apollo 11 Houston, we're ready for the TV. We're all configured at your convenience, over.
This is Apollo Control. While we're waiting for the television pictures to come in, we have in the control room here a vase full of long-stemmed red roses and a card saying, "To one and all concerned, job superbly done from a moonstruck Canadian." Continuing to stand by as we wait for the pictures to come from Columbia, here they come.
Houston, Apollo 11, over.
Roger, go ahead, 11, over.
Are you picking up our TV signal?
That's affirmative. We have it up on the outer four now. The focus is a little bit out. We see the Earth in the center of the screen. Still have a little white dot in the bottom of the camera, apparently. And see some land masses in the center. At least I guess that's what it is. It's very hazy this time on our outer four, over.
Let me change. I believe that's where we just came from.
It is, huh? Well, I'm really looking at a bad screen here. Stand by one. Hey, you're right.
Not bad enough. I'm
finally beginning to
get a glimmer
on your screen now.
It's not bad enough not finding the right landing spot. We ain't even got the right planet.
I'll never let that one down.
We're making it get smaller and smaller here to make sure that it really is the one we're leaving.
Oh, that's enough, you guys.
We know that a lot of scientists from a number of countries standing by to see the lunar samples, and we thought you'd be interested in seeing that they really are here. These two boxes are the sample return containers. They're vacuum-packed containers that were closed in a vacuum on the lunar surface, sealed, and then brought inside the LEM and put inside these fiberglass bags, zippered and resealed around the outside, and placed in these receptacles in the side of the command module. These are the two boxes, and as soon as we get onto the ship, I'm sure these boxes will immediately be transferred and delivery started to the lunar receiving laboratory. These boxes include the samples of various types of rock, the ground mass of the soil, the sand and silt, and the particle collector for the solar wind experiment, and the core tubes that took depth samples of the lunar surface.
Roger, Neil. Thank you much for that description. We've got a pretty dark picture down here. Could you check your f-stop? We'd like to have it, see if you can open it up a little bit, over.
Okay, our monitor showed that to be very bright.
We're down around between, around F4, which we thought would be plenty light. We'll lighten it up some more.
Well, we'd appreciate it. It's pretty dark on all our monitors here.
Okay, fine.
That's looking a lot better now, Neil. There's Buzz. Houston, we have an excellent picture now, over.
Yeah, how do you read me, Charlie?
Five by now, Buzz, over.
Okay. More mundane affair, now that we've left the moon, I'd like to trace through a little bit for you. Developments have taken place in the food department. I'm sure you've always type of a tank container. A little later, Mike will show you how the water gun operates with its new filter to take out the hydrogen. Essentially, this water gun is put in this end and filled up this bag with water, and the tank then dissolves in the water, and this end of the outfeeding. Likewise, we have other foods that are more solid nature. You can probably see this shrimp cocktail meal. This afternoon, while the two of us had salmon salad. Another early development was the use of bite-sized food.
11, Houston, Buzz, you're breaking up badly. Would you check your box, over?
Roger, how am I coming through now, Charlie?
Well, Roger, you're very clear when you come through. It's just that your box is not keying at every word, over.
Okay. These bite-sized objects were designed to remove the problem of having so many crumbs floating around in the cabin. So they designed a particular size that would be able to go into the mouth all at once. I think since all of our experience, we've discovered that we can progress a good bit further than that, back to some of the type meals that we have on Earth. Matter of fact, on this flight, we've carried along pieces of bread. And along with the bread, we have ham spread. And I'll show you, I hope, how easy it is to spread some ham. Environment of zero G. Discovered that it is quite easy to draw very familiar with.
Apollo 11 Houston, we notice your roll rate increasing. Would you please see if you can bring that down to about 0.4, so we'll be losing a high gain shortly. Over.
We can also use zero gravity to demonstrate many things that we've all learned in school. I'd like to demonstrate briefly how easy it is to find the action of a gyroscope. If I spin this can, we know that according to the equations of motion, that we would expect it, once this is given a spin, about, and has a spin axis in this direction, if we give it a particular torque, and I'll do this by pushing my hands against it in this fashion, once it's spinning, by the equations, we can predict that as I put this torque on it, it will in fact rotate this direction. Let's see how well this works out. Did, as I applied the torque this way, it rotated this way.
He says, pretty good demonstration.
Houston, up next is a little demonstration for the kids at home, all kids everywhere for that matter. I was going to show you how you drink water out of a spoon, but I'm afraid I filled the spoon too full, and if I'm not careful, I'm going to spill water right over the sides. Can you see the water flapping around in the top of the spoon, kid?
That's affirmative, 11.
Okay, well, as I say, I was going to tell you, but I'm afraid I filled it too full, and it's going to spill over the sides. I tell you what, I just turn this one over and get rid of the water and start all over again, okay?
Okay.
And you can see up here, we don't know where over is. One up is as good as another. That really is water, though, I'll tell you. That's really not the way we drink. We really have a water gun, which I'll show you. Here's the water gun. This cylindrical thing on the end of it is a filter with several membranes. One allows water to pass, but not any gas. The other allows gas to pass, but not any water. So by routing the gaseous water, which comes from our tanks,
through this filter, we're enabled to drink purified water without the gas in it, filtered water. And, of course, all we do to get it started is just pull the trigger. Sort of messy. I haven't been at this very long. It's the same system that the Spaniards used to drink out of wineskins at bullfights. Only I think this will be more fun. Well, be seeing you, kids.
Thank you from all the kids in the world here in the Moker who can't tell the earth from the moon.
All right, just stand by one and we'll get you that earth for you.
Looks like you need a wineskin up there, Mike.
That'd be nice.
Houston,
have a picture now, Houston.
That's affirmative. I refuse to bite on this one, though. You tell us.
Okay, this should be getting larger, and if it is, it's the place we're coming home to.
Roger.
This is Apollo Control, still up live with the air-to-ground circuit to Apollo 11, homeward bound. They're now in the passive thermal control mode, or barbecue mode. Charlie Duke's going to make another call to the crew. Let's listen in a moment. He's discussing with Flight Director Pete Frank, who tonight is spelling Gene Kranz on the shift, although Gene is here. They're discussing some adjustments to the passive thermal control mode. Some 53,666 miles behind it. And relative to the moon, Apollo 11 is traveling now at 4,306 feet per second. Continue to monitor air ground here until the crew settles down. They're not scheduled to go into their rest period until about another 4 hours from now.
Apollo 11 Houston, we were curious to see if there was any excess moisture up around the tunnel hatch area as we saw on 10, over.
It so happens that what we were talking about now, there is a little bit of dampness around the outside edge of the hatch, but very, very slight amount. We've got a hose up there that we're hoping we'll sort of help keep it a little bit dry.
Roger. Mike, thank you much. Have you seen any more water collecting on the aft bulkhead, over?
No, we haven't, as a matter of fact. It's been dry in that area since we got rid of that last time.
Roger. Thank you.
Back in PTC attitude, standing by for thruster quieting.
Roger, we see that. Thank you much, Mike.